John Murray Press presents The A to Z of Therapeutic Parenting, written and read by Sarah Naish. Introduction. I am a therapeutic parent, and I make no apologies for this. I'm doing what my children need me to do to help them become functioning members of society, to be able to show kindness, build relationships, and become effective parents themselves one day. I first started fostering in 1987. Things were a little different then, and foster carers were not very well supported. Moving three children from fostering to adoption inspired me to begin a career in social work. In 1992, I qualified as a social worker and began working with children and families, as well as fostering and adoption. After adopting my five children, who are all siblings, in 1998 and 1999, I became aware that my social work training had not equipped me to deal with the issues presented to me on a daily basis by my traumatised children. I had all my old nursery nursing skills, such as establishing boundaries and routines, but my children quickly taught me that my standard parenting strategies were now redundant. I also realised that I had inadvertently often given inaccurate advice to parents caring for traumatised children, and that there appeared to be a gap between what social workers are trained to do and the expectations of adopters and foster carers about their knowledge. In 2007, I took on the management and later ownership of a fostering agency that was struggling to obtain good outcomes. I implemented a whole therapeutic parenting approach using the TRUE model, which I devised in 2010. This model is explained fully in my first book on Therapeutic Parenting in a Nutshell, Naish 2016. Staff were fully trained in therapeutic parenting strategies and understood the correct way to support foster carers and the children in their care using the TRUE model and associated techniques. The agency obtained an Ofsted Outstanding grading in 2014 in recognition of our excellent outcomes and family stability. In 2015, I left the agency to move full-time into training and established Inspire Training Group, part of Fostering Attachments Limited. I had become more concerned about the distance between supporting professionals and parents. I went all over the country delivering training and was often told by carers and parents that they felt disillusioned, isolated, and blamed. I frequently heard that the system we were all working in was much harder to deal with than the children's behaviours. Although this was a sentiment I shared, I had not realised the problem was so widespread. As I was not able to find any research that was relevant to what I was seeing, I commissioned and supported, through Fostering Attachments Limited, the first comprehensive research into compassion fatigue in foster care in the UK, with the University of Bristol's Hadley Centre for Adoption and Foster Care Studies. This resulted in the final report, No One Told Us It Would Be Like This, Compassion Fatigue in Foster Care, Ottaway and Selwyn, 2016. The findings are referred to throughout this book. My eldest daughter, Rosie, who was now an adult, began delivering training and working alongside me. Parents frequently expressed the view that they found it invaluable to have Rosie's viewpoint to help them to adapt their parenting style. We were often asked if we could write a children's book from the perspective of a child who had experienced trauma. We decided to write a series of true stories based on our own family experiences, which would also help parents and children to understand where the behaviours were coming from and the best way to respond to these behaviours. My five children are represented in the books as Rosie Rudy, Katie Careful, William Wobbly, Sophie Spikey and Charlie Chatty. Throughout this book, I have referred to strategies within these stories which parents and carers may well find a useful complement. I also sometimes refer to my children by their book name, which helps to identify different characteristics more easily. Following the success of Therapeutic Parenting in a Nutshell, many therapeutic parents and supporting professionals told me how much they also needed a quick, practical reference guide covering all the day-to-day issues and challenges we face. I thought I would write a concise, jargon-free, behaviour-based A to Z, which was easy to navigate and solution-focused. I anticipated having about 25 topics, but after looking closely at all the subjects I'm asked about and asking other therapeutic parents what they needed, this quickly increased to over 60. I need to just get one thing clear though. I am not a perfect therapeutic parent. I spent several years making lots of mistakes, and even on good days, I would slip up more times than I care to mention. My children taught me everything I know about therapeutic parenting, as I had to constantly adapt my strategies to find a way to reparent them effectively. Although this book encapsulates all the strategies and solutions I have used personally and professionally, I have been given lots of ideas and input from all the thousands of adopters, foster carers, and other therapeutic parents in our Therapeutic Parents Facebook group. In this group, we noticed that we had the same issues and challenges coming up time and time again. Over the last 3 years, the site has accumulated a wealth of knowledge and essential strategies which parents have found hugely beneficial. All of that experience has now been funneled, sieved, and discussed to provide you with the concise and relevant information you need, often in a hurry. Some of the strategies and advice in this book do not fit in at all with standard parenting and might be new concepts for some supporting professionals in the field. But I felt it was essential to share strategies that other parents have found to make a fundamental, positive difference to the child. After all, at the end of the day, we are all working towards the same outcomes. Throughout the book, I mainly referred to the child and the parent. This is deliberate on my part, as our children are often functioning at a much younger age emotionally. Although our children need to be cared for, what they need most is parenting, therapeutic parenting. How to use this book. Part 1, The Basics. This section gives parents and carers an overview of common behaviours seen in many children who have either suffered trauma or experienced some other kind of maternal or postnatal stress leading to high levels of the hormone cortisol and/or sensory issues. This section also explains where these behaviours come from. It is a fundamental part of therapeutic parenting that we try our utmost to take on the child's perspective and understand where the behaviour is coming from. Otherwise, we cannot meet the challenges with the correct therapeutic response. Part 1 also gives an explanation of the most commonly used therapeutic parenting strategies, including the step-by-step parents model, which can be adapted to most situations. If you familiarise yourself with the explanations of behaviours and the overview of common therapeutic parenting strategies, including strategies to avoid, this will easily be understood when moving on to the references in Part 2. I have also included information on avoiding and resolving compassion fatigue, which is a debilitating condition and frequently a major factor in family placement breakdown. Part 2, the A to Z. Ideally, most parents will use this section to quickly look up the issue they are most concerned about. If you have an electronic version on your phone as an ebook, you can also quickly get to the subject you need, even in the middle of an incident. This section contains a list of common issues we face, listed as an A to Z. You will see that some topics are signposted to an overview. For example, manic laughter is included in overreacting. Each section explains what the behaviour or issue looks like, why it might happen, and the related strategies and points for consideration. Part 2 includes tried and tested therapeutic parenting methods for all the presenting problems I'm asked about most frequently. What is therapeutic parenting and who is it for? Therapeutic parenting is a term commonly used for foster carers, adopters, special guardians, and kinship carers who are looking after children who may have suffered trauma. This may be through early life neglect and/or abuse. Therapeutic parenting is also used for biological parents, particularly where there may have been pre-birth trauma, separation, illness, or any other factor affecting the child's functioning and understanding of the world or affecting their attachment. Many biological parents find therapeutic parenting styles useful to use with children who are on the autism spectrum or have high cortisol levels and/or attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. In fact, therapeutic parenting is beneficial for all children due to its reliance on firm boundaries and structure with a strong empathic and nurturing approach. Definitions. In our research with the Hadley Centre, University of Bristol, Ottaway and Selwyn, 2016, I wrote the following definition in the executive summary, page 4. Therapeutic parenting is a deeply nurturing parenting style with a foundation of self-awareness and a central core of mentalisation developed from consistent, empathic, insightful responses to a child's distress and behaviours, allowing the child to begin to self-regulate, develop an understanding of their own behaviours, and ultimately form secure attachments. The aim of therapeutic parenting is to enable the child to recover from the trauma they have experienced. This is done by developing new pathways in the child's brain to help them to link cause and effect, reduce their levels of fear and shame, and to help them start to make sense of their world. Therapeutic parenting in practice. Therapeutic parenting is a different way of life. Carers need to live as therapeutic parents with all their children. Luckily, therapeutic parenting is also extremely effective for securely attached children. It just works more quickly. Therapeutic parents are not therapists. They don't do formal therapy. They are simply parents who need to parent differently to help their children's brains to grow and make new connections. So our parenting looks different. We help our children to feel calmer when they are frightened and behaving badly from that fear. We use empathy to help our children to recognise their feelings. We have very clear boundaries and routines so our children can predict what might happen next. We always try to think about our children's emotional age and not their chronological age, as, to be honest, their chronological age is not very relevant. Being a therapeutic parent is a very tough job. Therapeutic parents live a life that is well structured with strict routines and boundaries. There are no surprises or spontaneous outings, and there is no room for doubt. This can be dull at times and frustrating for everyone. The strict routines may be misinterpreted as inflexibility by extended family or supporting professionals. Therapeutic parents often long for spontaneity and a change to routine, but have learned to their cost that there is always a price to pay for these deviations. We can't always be therapeutic, no matter how hard we try, but we just need to be as therapeutic as we can, whenever we can. After all, we are only human. How long will it take to see a difference? Therapeutically reparenting a traumatised child is a very long job. It won't be done in a couple of years. We can see some small improvements quite quickly, but they are external changes. The big change is the one where there are fundamental shifts in the child's internal working model. This is all about how the child sees themselves and their relationship with the world. Some of the indicators of progress are when we see that the child feels safe and can demonstrate empathy, link cause and effect, think before acting, trust adults to meet their needs, maintain a healthy, reciprocal friendship for more than 6 months, admit when they have made a mistake without experiencing toxic shame, feel and demonstrate remorse when they have made a mistake. All that will take a very long time, and probably more than 10 years. In the meantime, though, we do see other improvements and steps along the way towards these goals. Many parents feel frustrated and desperate as the years go by with seemingly no change. Don't underestimate how the small steps all add up to the total length of the journey. When my children were growing up, I found the following analogy useful to keep in mind. The trauma lake. Let's imagine we are standing on a shoreline with a still, flat lake in front of us. It's called Trauma Lake. Every time I tried an intervention or resolved a difficult day, I was throwing a rock in that lake. It made a few ripples, but after a few moments, nothing had changed, and I felt as if I was back where we all started. With the benefit of hindsight, I now realise that every therapeutic parenting intervention I did, every phrase, every resolved horrendous challenge was a solid rock, a building block being put in place. But my children's trauma lake was deep. Sure enough, over the years, the rock started to break the surface of the water and we saw a different child in a different landscape. They couldn't have surfaced above the trauma without the blocks I had first put in there. All that time, and I thought nothing was changing. Part 1, The Basics. Chapter 1, Why Our Children Do the Things They Do. Often, we can be frustrated by our children's actions. Even more frequently, people around us do not understand how we live and what we are trying to deal with. When we think of our children moving forwards in life and having been given the wrong signals and equipment to start off with, it's much easier to understand why our children do the things they do. In her book, Everyday Parenting with Security and Love, Kim Golding, 2017, explains in great detail the reasons some children have attachment difficulties and the relationship these have to trauma and other causational factors. If you are reparenting a child who has been subjected to abuse and/or neglect, it's useful to think of their actions in this way. The child car driver. Someone put my child in the driver's seat of a car. Even worse, it was someone who should have been looking after my child. Even worse, the steering wheel was tampered with to make the car turn left when the child turned right. To make it harder, someone cut the brakes. Then, this person started the ignition and fixed the accelerator pedal down to the floor to make it speed off. My child was in the driver's seat of a car that couldn't stop, went the wrong way, and was moving fast. Now, people keep blaming my child for crashing into things, for going too fast, for being afraid, for damaging things, or for hurting people. The social worker put me in the passenger seat and asked me to help my child. Sadly, she suggested doing a theory test first, but that's way down our list of priorities. Gradually, I am teaching my child to use the handbrake and to manage the steering. They are less fearful just because I'm sitting next to them, always sitting next to them. All we need now is for people to stop telling us that my child needs to pass a driving test. This therapeutic parent driving instructor is just trying to get us all to our destination in one piece. Common behaviours and underlying factors. Many of the behaviours we see in our children are fear-based responses, but they may not appear to us in that way. Indeed, our child may present as rude, defiant, and attention-seeking. If we bear in mind the car driver and start from the basis that a child who has suffered some kind of trauma in their early life often feels out of control and experiences the world very differently, some of their behaviours start to make sense. Fear. Our children are often terrified of everyday objects, changes in routine, any type of transition, the dark, food. In fact, the traumatised child's overriding emotion is nearly always one of fear. The fear is masked, though, and we may experience it as anger or controlling behaviours. This is why we might see an escalation of defiance when there is an approaching transition. It's also very disconcerting to realise that often what our children are most scared of are adults. This is upsetting for parents and something they may not have considered. If your child appears to be rejecting everything, is unable to ask for help and follows you around, seemingly ever watchful, consider that you may be the source of fear as well as comfort. My friend, Sarah Dillon, grew up in care and is now an attachment therapist. She describes the fear of adults in this way. If you are scared of something, really scared, what do you do? Say you have a phobia of spiders and one suddenly appears. What happens? You might freeze, feel panicky. You may try to run away or even kill it. You can't think straight. You might keep a very close eye on that spider so you know where it is at all times. Well, I felt that way about adults. Adults were the source of my trauma and phobia, and every time I was moved, I had a new spider to get used to. Sarah Dillon. Unable to reattune. As our children are often fearful of adults and may have had negative experiences, it is almost impossible for them to reattune to the parent following an incident. If we think of a securely attached young child who has committed some mild misdemeanor, the parent may well withdraw their approval as a means of letting the child know they are not happy with them. A securely attached child will usually move quickly to repair the relationship and reattune, perhaps by seeking comfort or testing out the parent's response. A child who is fearful of adults or overwhelmed with shame is entirely unable to make the first move and will remain stuck, defensive, and sad. blocked trust. If the child has not learned that the parent or carer is reliable and trustworthy, then they are unable to rely on them to meet even their basic needs. Our children are often mistrustful of our intentions and find it difficult to interpret our actions, even to read facial expressions. The term blocked trust is also used to describe the child not feeling good enough about themselves in Dan Hughes and Jonathan Balin's book, The Neurobiology of Attachment Focus Therapy, 2016. I have expanded on this later on in the sections Sense of Self and Impact of Shame and A Compulsion to Break a Forming Attachment. Impulsivity. Our children often have high cortisol levels and are hardwired to respond to stress and risk very quickly. They lack the usual impulse controls and can often blurt out what they are thinking or act without thinking at all. These actions are more reminiscent of a very young toddler or baby, as it is possible the child has missed out important developmental stages. Sometimes these behaviours look like ADHD. The child may have lived in an environment where they always needed to be alert and ready for action, or they may have experienced other trauma that has affected their brain development. Lack of cause and effect thinking. Where our children have suffered some kind of trauma in their lives, nothing is predictable. Their early lives may have made no sense. My children did not know the difference between night and day. If even the basics of human existence make no sense, then it is much harder for the more complex layers to be ordered into a fathomable structure by these children. As the children tend to act quickly on impulse without forward planning, they often suffer as a direct result of their own actions. This is because many of our own inhibitors stem from the fact that we don't want to feel bad later. For example, we might not steal £10 from the kitchen table because we know we might get in trouble or we don't want to feel bad. Our children cannot project forward and think about how they might feel later. In effect, they lack empathy for their future self. Control and power issues. See also part 2, controlling behaviours. It's really useful to turn this particular behaviour on its head. We see it as their need to control, but our children are behaving in this way just to keep themselves safe. The antidote to the all-consuming fear that the child feels is to be in control. After all, if you are powerful, you are more likely to survive. Control is a fear-based behaviour, and their behaviour is saying, "I can't trust adults to be in charge yet." Our children need to feel powerful, but at the same time are deeply conflicted, as ultimately, most of them have a profound, unmet need for the adult to be in charge, safe and nurturing. Lack of empathy. Empathy is usually one of the last skills to develop. Our children need to have all their basic needs met before they can build on those and develop the more profound human characteristics, such as empathy, gratitude and remorse. I have found that in general, children who have suffered trauma in early life need to have been responded to empathically, as in modelled empathy, for about 7 to 10 years before they can start to genuinely experience and demonstrate it. Lack of remorse. Parents often panic a little that their child might be evil because they show no remorse or empathy. Remorse is also a sophisticated emotion which our children may not yet be able to access. This doesn't make them evil. In securely attached children, we see remorse being established around the age of 6 or 7. If the child spent a lot of their early life dealing with a stressful environment, then there will not have been time to lay down the foundations for remorse to be established. Once the secure attachments have been made, the child begins to demonstrate some empathy or the ability to take on the perspective of another, and remorse will follow. My children did not develop remorse until they were aged between 13 and 22. Hypervigilance. Our children's very existence may have depended on the need for them to be hypervigilant. Until she was 26 years old, my eldest daughter could not sleep unless she was facing the door, and even then this needed some therapeutic intervention. Our children often don't know if the parent is going to disappear completely. Perhaps they have in the past. For this reason, they often have very good visual skills. Hypervigilance does not leave very much room for other things. If you have to remember where everyone is in the class, what they are wearing, and what they are doing, there's not much space left for learning. Sadness, grief, and loss. It is sometimes easier to put to one side the enormous losses our children may have suffered. With loss comes sadness and grief. Children are moved between different foster carers to whom they may have formed attachments, then expected to show joy on placement with their adopters. They may be grieving for an absent parent, even if they were abusive. That is what the child knows, and the child may be feeling it is all somehow their fault. Most parents and carers are naturally very empathetic and understanding about this and give the child permission and space to grieve. Grief can be expressed as anger, defensiveness, and controlling behaviours. The child does not want to lose anything else in their life. With fostering and adoption, there is often a direct conflict between the positive anticipation of the parent-carer and the sadness and grief of the child who feels compelled to keep themselves safe by attempting to meet the expectations of the new parent. See honeymoon period in the A to Z. Fear of invisibility. When a child has suffered from unreliable parenting, neglect or abuse, they may have a deep-rooted fear of being forgotten or invisible. They will certainly have felt invisible at times. If you are dependent on powerful adults to feed you and keep you safe, but you appear to be invisible, you might die. When our children are scared of being forgotten, we see some of the most powerful behaviours, such as nonsense chatter, anxiety-based behaviours, following, and aggressive or rude behaviours designed to press the parents' buttons and forcibly remind them that the child is there. Anger. We often see anger as a constant, visible emotion in our children. Anger can be a defensive mechanism to avoid showing sadness. In order to be sad, our children need to display their vulnerability, and this is something they don't feel safe enough to do, so they use their anger like a protective shell. The shell is made up of rudeness, defiance, and hostility, which seems to ooze from the child. The angry message is, "Don't touch me, don't help me, don't come near me." See more details on this in aggression. In our series of therapeutic parenting children's stories, we show the shell on Rosie Rudy in her first book, Naish and Jeffries, 2016. The child's internal working model, recreating a familiar environment. Some behaviours that appear quite bizarre to parents may be completely familiar and normal for the child. Where there is bedwetting, for example, the smell of urine might have been very much part of the child's early environment, especially in cases of neglect. For the child, therefore, this is not an offensive smell. They don't notice it. The smell of urine is a manifestation of the child's internal working model. Similarly, parents sometimes express dismay when their adopted teenagers seem to suddenly gravitate towards families where there may be drug or alcohol abuse, a lack of routine, and maybe even violence. This can be because the child recognises the currency of the interactions and relationships. While it may not feel safe, it does feel familiar, and maybe even as if they belong. Sometimes this is also referred to as stimulating the environment. As the child stimulates their new environment to try to recreate familiar relationship patterns, this happens on a very deep level and is instinctive. The child does not think consciously and plan for this to happen. Sense of self and impact of shame. If a child has not had their early, most basic needs met, they are consumed with a toxic form of shame. Our children work hard to stay out of this shame because it is truly devastating and all-consuming. Some of the behaviours we see that relate to shame avoidance are lying, an inability to take responsibility, self-sabotage. The child gets their sense of self from the actions of the people around them. If they are ignored or abused, their sense of self is one of worthlessness and badness. Guilt can be described as, "I did something bad." Shame is more like, "I am bad." Brown, 2012. This feeling of badness is internalised, so the child's internal working model might be, "I am bad, I am unimportant, I am unlovable." It is not a decision they have made, it is the way their brain has been wired. The hapless parent who tries to tell this child they are wonderful will likely be viewed at best as unreliable or easy to trick, or at worst as a liar by the child. A compulsion to break a forming attachment with the parent. See also Part 2, Sabotaging. At the very time when it looks like we might have a breakthrough moment and be forming some meaningful connections, the child appears to up the ante. We have a good day and then it is ruined. We get the child a much sought-after gift and they destroy it. We must bear in mind the conflict that exists within the child. If their internal working model is one of badness and we do something that makes them feel that they might be good, they are unable to reconcile these difficult feelings. This is when we see the child at their most destructive or hurtful. They are compelled, through survival instincts, to create emotional distance and pull away. Where there are loyalties to previous carers or parents, this compulsion to break a newly forming attachment is even more pronounced. This is not thought through or planned in any way. Even securely attached adults may unknowingly sabotage or end a promising relationship if they have been hurt in the past and wish to safeguard themselves emotionally. With traumatized children, this is much more pronounced and much harder to unpick. Sensory issues. Many of the children who benefit from therapeutic parenting have sensory issues. This can be for a number of reasons. They may have been exposed to high levels of cortisol or stress, or they may have experienced danger, risk, and a frightening environment leading to changes in the brain. Some children are diagnosed or misdiagnosed with sensory processing disorder, where everything is magnified and it can be really difficult for the child not to feel overwhelmed and to go into fight, flight, freeze, or defensive rage when overstimulated. All of these responses come from the base brain and are instinctual. This is why we often see the worst behaviours if we take children to a supermarket or holiday park. The wealth and intensity of sensory input is simply too difficult to manage, and the child experiences a sensory collapse, which we may experience as a tantrum. Sensory issues may be indicated if you see that the child has sensitive hearing, jumps or flinches at loud noises or movements, overreacts, exhibits challenging behaviour when there are certain types of high wattage overhead or flashing lights, needs sensory oral stimulation and or is orally oversensitive, cannot tolerate certain sensations on their skin, such as labels on clothing. Throughout this book, I give examples of strategies to help with sensory issues relating to topic headings. Some children benefit from using fiddle toys, vibrating cushions, and even lying on a chair and hanging their head upside down. Interoception. Interoception is a difficulty in interpreting the body's internal signals. Children who have not had their physical needs met have often not developed the correct pathways in their brain that carry signals around pain, temperature, thirst, hunger, and satiety. This is the reason that we see our children either overreacting to small injuries or appearing not to notice more serious injuries. By the same token, they may eat a large meal and then say they are still hungry. The child is not lying. They can't feel that they are full up. The child may get very cold or very hot and be unaware of this. We frequently see our children inappropriately clothed despite our best efforts. Cortisol levels. Our children are addicted to sugar almost like a drug, and this is fueled by high levels of cortisol. A child may have high cortisol levels for a number of reasons, many not associated with abuse. High levels of cortisol drive us to act. Normally, we would experience a rush of cortisol in response to a stressful situation. It compels us to move or to reach for the biscuit tin. If those levels of cortisol are high for a lot of the time, we see our children being restless, fidgety, unable to concentrate, and craving sugar. If the sugar craving or need for movement can't be satisfied, then the child goes into fight, flight, or defensive rage. It's not much to do with them being in control. It's about them being controlled by sugar and cortisol. Taking high sugar foods is driven by high cortisol levels and is outside our children's control. Literalness. As the more advanced human skills such as empathy and remorse develop later on in our children, often the capacity for humour is also absent. We have to be very careful as our children may lack creative thinking and can be very literal. Sometimes our children can appear to pour cold water on the lovely imaginative games of other children. I also remember the gasps of horror when I told my children to keep their eyes peeled. Chapter 2. A word about developmental trauma and related disorders. The term developmental trauma disorder, DTD, really encompasses all of what we see in our traumatised children and more. There has been a huge campaign by Dr. Bessel van der Kolk and his colleagues in the USA, 2015, to get DDT recognised and included in the Mental Health Diagnostic Manual, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, DSM-5. Sadly, however, despite his research evidencing the existence of DTD, it is still not included as an official diagnosis. Attachment disorder, or reactive attachment disorder, RAD, is a serious symptom but a watered-down version, and even that is often not diagnosed at all. As far as diagnoses are concerned, the experience of many therapeutic parents is that it is very rare for a thorough quality assessment to be undertaken that separates out the different diagnoses, or rather symptoms, of an underlying disorder in a child who has suffered early life trauma. Many of the behaviours and disorders we see are really symptoms of developmental trauma disorder, and once van der Kolk manages to get that recognised, we might all finally get the support our children need. You may notice that in this book I don't mention too much about attachment, nor all the other diagnoses our children may have. There is a reason for this. Typically, developmental trauma will result in a whole range of associated disorders, such as post-traumatic stress disorder, attachment disorder or reactive attachment disorder, sensory processing disorder, ADHD, oppositional defiance disorder, pathological demand avoidance, autism, dyspraxia. Birth parents who use therapeutic parenting are often doing so because of pre-birth early trauma and resulting high cortisol levels. This frequently mimics many of the conditions and symptoms that we see above. Fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, FASD, is often present and sometimes diagnosed in children who have suffered pre-birth trauma due to the effects of alcohol during pregnancy. The presenting behaviours and characteristics may appear very similar to attachment difficulties and are difficult to distinguish. I found that therapeutic parenting techniques were equally effective when parenting children with FASD, as this was rarely a standalone condition. The majority of therapeutic parents I have contact with who are caring for children suffering from the effects of early life trauma and abuse report that their children display many of the characteristics of the above conditions. Sometimes diagnoses might help to unlock resources, funding, and assistance. Often the diagnoses are contradictory and confusing. Furthermore, we also find that when we look at different insecure attachment styles, ambivalent, anxious, avoidant, disorganised, our children are too quickly pigeonholed into one particular style. Our children are rarely consistently functioning within the descriptors of one attachment style, but instead shift between the attachment styles depending on who they are with, how safe they feel, and where they are in their emotional development. For example, for the first 4 years Rosie was with me, she would have been described as ambivalent attachment. She was rejecting, rude, defensive, angry, and aggressive. The reality was that she was also avoidant, not wanting to ask for or accept help, as well as ambivalent in that she did not expect me to meet her needs. To me, she was Rosie, and we just took each day or hour as it came. I found it much easier to take a holistic view. I avoided overanalyzing different diagnoses and attachment styles, but took on board useful information about them, such as the similarities and helpful strategies linked to dyspraxia with regard to my children's clumsiness and disorganisation. Chapter 3. The Essential Foundations of Therapeutic Parenting. Therapeutic parenting is founded primarily on boundaries and structure. it is not possible to use the more effective strands to therapeutic parenting without this essential foundation. Our children often come from a place where they were lacking the structure of routine, boundaries, and safety. So the first way we can help them to feel safe enough to learn and grow is by making their lives predictable. We do this through routine, being the unassailable safe base, being honest, having strong, clear boundaries, allowing natural consequences, accessing appropriate therapy. Now let's look at each of these areas in turn. Establish a strong routine. Routine enables the child to predict important events such as when they will eat, go to sleep, or go to school. We need to ensure that snacks and meals are provided at the same time every day. Any slight change in routine can lead to the child becoming dysregulated and distressed. This routine will need to be kept for many years, and it can be frustrating and disheartening. The parents would often like more spontaneity in their lives, but learn quickly that they pay the price for deviating from the established routine. On top of this, parents may be judged harshly by others who do not understand the importance of the routine as inflexible. Establish yourself as the unassailable safe base. As the parent, if we begin by establishing ourselves as the unassailable safe base, it gives the child a safe space to start to test boundaries. Being the unassailable safe base does not mean that we are not approachable, warm, and nurturing, quite the opposite. It does, however, mean that the child can rely on us to be very consistent, to say what we mean, and do what we say. We move forward to our timetable without being distracted by the child's attempt to control us. The skilled therapeutic parent knows that the child needs us to be in control, even though we are establishing control through empathic and nurturing methods. I used to envisage myself as a steam train. Behind me, I was dragging five little carriages. Unfortunately, there was a parallel track, and very often, several times a day in fact, one of my little carriages would attempt to jump tracks and take me off in a different direction. Well, I knew that I was heading to Secure Attachment Station, and nothing was going to turn me from that. So, in the morning, when we were trying to leave the house, and one of my children decided they were not going to put their shoes on, the steam train would pick up the shoes and walk out the door anyway. A little carriage then jumped back on the track behind the steam train and continued towards our ultimate destination. If we jump tracks and follow our children to their destination, we will all end up in the wrong place. Our children can only bully or control us if we allow them to. Let's explore the carer being controlled by the child. As the child demands something or adjusts their behaviour to provoke a response, the carer rewards the child with their emotional response. The child feels unsafe in this situation and negative behaviour will increase. The stress levels in the carer will also increase and the relationship is unlikely to flourish while maintaining this pattern. Later in this book, I will give you lots of strategies you can use to avoid reacting emotionally and getting caught up in this negative cycle. Let's now explore what happens when the carer is not reacting to the child's demands emotionally. This does not mean that they are not responding to the child. So, for example, the child might be demanding to have a biscuit, and the carer might be responding with, "I can see you are hungry." The carer remains consistent and present, and is not being controlled by the child. Although it may look like the carer is being harsh, they are actually enabling the child to feel safe. Be honest. It is vital to say what you mean and mean what you say. Our children can spot dishonesty at 100 paces. This does not mean that we blatantly offer up information that the child does not need or will not benefit from. For example, we don't have to tell them that we are going on holiday in 6 months' time. We also avoid talking about an event which might happen. If I thought I might take them to the park later and there was any doubt whatsoever, I did not share this information with the child. The words might and perhaps did not exist in our house. Part of being the unassailable safe base is honesty in relation to anything in the child's life story, contact, and all the other confusing issues our children have to contend with. As the unassailable safe base, you need to make sure that you are honest in order to preserve and nurture the relationship. Naturally, we are very focused on promoting positive parts of traumatic early life histories as we want our children to have good self-esteem and to feel loved. We have to exercise caution about going too far down that path. Helen Oakwater's book, Bubble Wrap Children, 2012, explains the consequences of sugarcoating unpalatable trauma-filled early life histories, especially relating to the risks of social media and related later discoveries. Here are two statements from children, now adults, who were removed from very abusive birth parents. Beatrice. When I was in foster care, I used to have contact with my birth parents. It was a very distressing time for me, as I was taken somewhere safe and then had to go and see the people that I feared most in the world. My adoptive mum never lied about how my birth parents cared for us. She never bad-mouthed them either or said anything about her own feelings. She always spoke factually about them, answering any questions we had. As we grew and had more questions, she would go into more detail, being extremely sensitive. Sometimes, I would find some of the very abusive things hard and would get upset, and Mum would explain how it made her very sad too that these things happened to us. She never used negativity, just facts. I am so glad she never told us that our birth parents loved us, because I know for a fact they did not. I remembered a lot of things. If I had been told that was love, I would not have understood what love meant, and I would have known my mum was lying to me. A few years ago, I asked my mum for every detail she had on my birth parents, as I felt there was always this open box of worries and questions. Now, by knowing my history and everything that happened, it's helped me to get to a point where I am no longer angry about what my birth parents did, but I never want to seek them out to find out why or how. Sometimes I do feel sad, as some of the things I know are hard to get over, but I am glad I have the truth. Donna. I am a child of abusive and neglectful parents. As I sort through the very last shred of unexposed trauma, now in therapy, I'm aware that some of the most memorable, hurtful, demeaning and lonely-making conversations of my young life were when people with good intentions were telling me that my parents loved me. I can't forgive them for it. It doubled, tripled the harm. What hurt so much about these conversations was that they were overridden by this social convention that things should be nice, things should be okay, so I was supposed to take care of this adult by pretending to them that things were okay. And they weren't. And we wouldn't have been having this conversation unless the adult had known that to some extent, because I never willfully disclosed to anyone. So I would resent having to make them feel better before they went home to their safe houses where people cared about them, and it would feel like a door closing. This is one less safe adult. This is one more person I know won't help me, who I can't tell the truth to because they can't handle it. And surprise, surprise, I had a great distrust of authority and still an overriding need to handle things myself. It was just this wave of distrust that would come over me. Nobody would save me but me. And indeed, no one ever did. And that makes me so sad when I think back to them and I want to yell, "You were an adult!" What people didn't realise is that it isn't like I just concluded that they never loved me and then never thought of it again. Of course, the question would be with me my whole life, and, as an adult, I would be able to see that probably, in their version of history, they did love me and did their best and blah blah. But that doesn't mean it was okay. Now I can see that both of those things can coexist. But as a child, I could not understand that, and I needed one thing to be true so that I could sort myself out on that basis. Them supposedly loving me wasn't freeing, it was a prison. But them being abusive garbage was freeing. But it didn't help me as a kid, especially since I didn't ask those people if my parents loved me. They just came in telling me that to make themselves feel better because they were saying something positive. Take what you will from my experience. Stay honest. Don't patronise. Don't sugarcoat. You build strong adults that way. If they don't ask you, don't get into that aspect. If they ask you, talk about how complicated and dark the truth is. Talk about generational abuse and how you and they are breaking the cycle. Talk about how much it hurts you to not know what to say. Just be completely real. You're doing an incredibly beautiful thing for them. Establish strong, clear boundaries. Therapeutic parents are clear about keeping very firm boundaries that may not be breached. This is all part of the structure that our children require, as they need us to be exact about where the boundaries are and what our expectations are too. I gave my children instructions rather than making a request. A request can be interpreted as an option or choice, so it is confusing to children who have communication difficulties. So instead of, "Please can you lay the table?" I might say, "It's time to lay the table now." Sometimes people who are unfamiliar with the whole range of therapeutic parenting strategies and models seem to believe that we must never show anger or disappointment with the child for breaking a boundary. There is a fine line between being controlled by the child and feeling disempowered and angry, and showing appropriate anger and disappointment when a boundary is broken. For example, if your child punches a younger sibling in the face, the therapeutic parent may well initially shout at the child and say, "No, that is not okay," while moving the child away quickly. Some parents think this is not therapeutic parenting, but it is. If a child breaks a boundary, it is fine to let them know in no uncertain terms that this is not acceptable. Often, a parent will say to me, "I really messed up today. I wasn't therapeutic at all. I shouted at my child." The parent feels that they should respond in an empathic manner at all times, but this is not realistic, nor does it prepare our children for real life. If the child has broken the boundary, you need to let them know that they have broken that boundary and it is unacceptable. Although we can empathise with the underlying issues later on, children need to know when they are going down the wrong path. Don't be afraid to show when behaviour has crossed the line, but be careful about revealing personal hurt and sadness, in case this is used as a new button to press. Use natural or life consequences. In early life, our children's lives may have made little sense to them. They may not have realised that night followed day, or that food came when they were hungry, for example. Because of this, the child's brain has developed in such a way that cause and effect are not linked very well, and many of our children have an internal frame of reference that basically says, "I have no impact on the world, I am invisible." Natural consequences are the life consequences that follow, usually when a boundary is broken or the child has made a bad choice. We set our boundaries and then, when they are breached, usually through immaturity and the lack of cause and effect thinking, we show our children that they have made an impact on the world through natural consequences with nurture. If we fail to do that, we are setting us all up to fail in the long run. We are reinforcing the message that the child's actions are of no consequence. I use natural consequences to build synapses in my child's brain, which linked cause and effect, and the world started to make sense to them. Natural consequences must be used with nurture. It is sometimes too tempting to over-punish the child through manipulating consequences and calling them natural consequences. The natural consequence of the child going out without a coat on is that the child gets cold, and we help them to realise this. Once we show that they are cold by perhaps helping them to touch their skin with their hand, we might offer them something nurturing or warming. A natural consequence would not be that the coat is removed as a punishment for a week. With my children, I also extended and linked natural consequences where necessary. So, for example, if the child was rude to me and said I was stupid, later on I might say, "Unfortunately, I'm too stupid to drive. I seem to have forgotten how to do it. I won't be able to drive you to football." Pause for screeches of horror, etc. I would often nurture, wonder aloud, and empathise about how sad it is the child couldn't go. But I didn't want them to feel unsafe, and as if I had definitely forgotten how to drive for now. Listen to rudeness in part 2 for more examples. Throughout the A to Z part of this book, there are lots of examples of natural consequences related to specific challenges. Access therapy that complements therapeutic parenting. Generally, therapeutic parents find that therapy that includes the parent is the most effective for children who have suffered early life trauma. Therapeutic parents tend to prefer therapeutic models of intervention where the therapist is a skilled facilitator, the parent is included as the attachment figure, and the parent and child are able to build understanding. This helps the child to feel safe, and for effective communication to be had, where the child may be confused about traumatic events and their timeline. As the main goal is to promote secure attachments with the main carers, therapists must be knowledgeable about the effects of child trauma and the role of the therapeutic parent, and be open to the possibilities of triangulation, sometimes referred to as splitting. This is when the child presents differently with a therapist or another adult, and can lead to confusion and miscommunication. I explain this further in part 2 under triangulation. Therapeutic parents have found that the model of dyadic developmental psychotherapy, developed by Dan Hughes, 2016, and also called attachment-focused family therapy, to be an extremely supportive method of intervention, along with theraplay, attachment therapy, filial therapy, family therapy. Chapter 4: The Parents' Model of Intervention for Therapeutic Parents. Now that we have the foundations of understanding about where our children are coming from and have established a safe structure, we need a process to help us tackle all the incidents that occur on a day-by-day basis. There are several models of therapeutic parenting. The best known one is PACE: playfulness, acceptance, curiosity, empathy, described in Dan Hughes and Kim Golding's book, 2012. I always struggled, however, with the fact that none of the models seemed to give me a process to work through, so I stopped and thought about the ideal way to progress through an incident. It's so easy to forget the basics sometimes. When our children are in crisis, an incident can seem to come from nowhere and catch us unawares. The frequency and intensity are exhausting and debilitating. The next time you find yourself in this situation, it might be useful to run this checklist in your head for a more structured approach. From the moment of an incident, P, pause, breathe, respond consciously, not emotionally, step back, mentally and physically. A, assess. Is there any immediate danger to anyone or likely serious damage? R, reflect. Triggers. What is happening? Where is the child coming from? E, empathise. Express empathy for the difficulty the child is experiencing. Wonder aloud. N, nurture. Offer nurture, touch or parental presence, a drink, etc. T, think. What other strategies might resolve this? Is there a natural consequence? Can I name the need? What can I change to avoid this happening in the future? S, self-care. What can I do to make myself feel better? Need to recover in order to reattune with child, leading to resolution.
Now let's break it down. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.